Hi everyone. Today in AP Bio, we are going to go over an example of water potential. We're going to be talking about how water moves through plants today. So to get started with just an overview, so water movement through plants is really important. It is a physical force that drives the transport of not just water, but other materials through a long range of distances. So think about like a tree, for example. Trees have to transport water a very long way from the roots all the way up many, many feet in the air, right? And so how can that happen? How can a tree pull water up to the very top without going against gravity, basically? So how does that happen? That's what we're gonna learn about today. Transport in plants occurs on three different levels. It happens within a cell. So we have transport on a cellular level, and that should be pretty clear, just simple diffusion in a cell. And then we have cell-to-cell transport. Remember that plants have the plasmodesmata that allows cytoplasm to go through multiple cells, and we also have liquids that can move along the cell wall. And then we have long distance, which is through vessels called xylem and phloem. And this is the entire plant level. Transport occurs by three different mechanisms. We've got osmosis and diffusion, which you know about. We have active transport. And then we have bulk flow, which bulk flow sounds very complicated, but it really isn't. It's just sort of the combination of these two. So let's begin by looking at the things that happen in plants and that get transported. We're going to begin with water and minerals. Minerals are typically dissolved in water, and water and minerals get transported in a plant through little structures called the xylem. Xylem are little tiny tubes, think like little tiny straws, that go all the way up from the roots to the shoots of the plant, all the way up. This is where transpiration happens. So transpiration is when water evaporates out of a plant, like you see in the leaves of this plant. So plants are constantly losing water. And because water is being lost, more water gets pulled up to replace it, just like a straw. When you suck out liquid from the straw, more water comes up to replace it. Same thing is happening in a plant. And water moves from the soil through the roots all the way up. Okay, that happens via negative pressure. Now, why do we say it's negative pressure? It's really negative pressure because water is evaporating and it's creating almost like a vacuum in the xylem. And so more water gets pulled up to replace what is lost. So you have this combination of evaporation, it's written here, adhesion to the walls of the xylem, and cohesion to other water molecules, and that's what's causing the movement in the xylem, all three of these things. And this is like negative pressure because it's being sucked up. Sugars. Sugars are transported in vessels similar to the xylem, but they are called the phloem. They have a slightly different purpose. This is called bulk flow. This is because large amounts of this very sugary sap or sugary liquid are going to be moving through a plant. Now, why do we have to have these specialized transport vessels? It's because sugar is made in the leaves, but we don't necessarily want to keep the sugar in the leaves in the long term. We want sugars all over the plants. If it's a fruiting plant, we need sugar in the fruit. If it is like a root vegetable, we need sugar down in the roots, and we have to have phloem to move that sugary liquid to wherever it needs to go. This is through positive pressure because what's happening is the sugar is being created and it is being loaded into the phloem and it's being pushed usually in the downward direction. So positive pressure. And then we have gas exchange. Gas exchange happens through photosynthesis. We bring carbon dioxide in. Plants bring that in and plants exhale, as it were, oxygen out. And that happens in the leaves through a tiny little structure called the stomata. Plants also undergo cell respiration just like animals. So plants also need a little bit of oxygen in and they bring CO2 out. So if you notice, those two things are kind of opposites and plants do both of them. Plants need both CO2 and O2 and they exhale CO2 and O2. Photosynthesis is usually the thing that happens in a greater quantity though. All right. And then roots exchange gas with the soil. So there is gas in the soil as well. Okay. So here we have a view of how water moves. So water moves into the root and then it is pulled up the xylem all the way to the leaves. The leaves have stomata and the water evaporates out, right? So the roots, water moves in through osmosis. Right, roots are all branched out. Actually, many roots have tiny little hairs to increase that surface area to absorb as much water as possible. You may have noticed that if you've seen plant roots. They have little tiny root hairs to increase surface area. So water uses osmosis to move into the root, and then cohesion and adhesion and evaporation pull the water up, and evaporation makes the water leave the plant. So we have a lot happening there. All right, so how do water and minerals get from the soil to the vascular tissue? What do we mean when we say vascular tissue? Well, when we say vascular tissue, we are referring to the xylem and the phloem. So this term here, xylem and the phloem is what we're talking about. So how do water and minerals get from the soil to there? Well, we have specialized proteins called symporters. If you remember this from before, a symporter is a transport protein that brings two things in the same way. In this case, the symporter is going to bring in hydrogen ions at the same time that it brings in other minerals. So this is going to be important. Water and minerals enter the plant through the roots. So the first thing that has to happen is minerals need to be pumped in to the root. So pumping, is that active or passive? You should know that pumping minerals into the root is active. So we are going to end up with lots and lots of minerals in the roots. And if we have more minerals in the roots than outside the roots, because there's actually not that many minerals in the soil, then what's going to happen to the water in the soil? Well, the water in the soil is going to move via osmosis in. So that is basically what's happening. The concentration of minerals in the soil water is usually low, much lower than the concentration within the plant cells. In general, most minerals are moved into a root against their gradient by active transport. And you see that happening here. We are symporting in different minerals. Here we have potassium being pumped in and chloride ion being pumped in. And other minerals get pumped into the roots through these symporters or through other active transport proteins. This one here is a symporter. It is bringing in hydrogen ions and chloride ions. These two things have to be brought in at the same time. All right, minerals and ions pumped into the root cells, then move into the plant tissues. Here's more pictures of symporters bringing in nitrate. And then that second, this is the nitrate picture. And then we have another co-transporter bringing in some other solute. Doesn't always have to be an ion. So we have pumping minerals in. What happens to the water potential between the soil and root cells? So think about this. If we've got water moving from the soil to the root, the water potential in the soil must be high, and the water potential in the root must be lower. Right? Because water potential always moves from high to low. That should make sense. If we know there's more solute in the root, that means the water potential has to be lower there. All right, water moves through osmosis into the root at that point. We know that water is going to use aquaporins. All right, and there we see the water moving from the root to the xylem, up the xylem, and this is showing out the leaf. And then we know that minerals move through active transport with proton pumps. All right. Once water and minerals cross the root cells, they make it to the xylem. The xylem is the blue part in the middle. And water is going to crawl up the xylem thanks to the vacuum created by evaporation, thanks to cohesion and adhesion. Water can start to crawl up the xylem. These other parts you don't need to worry about. All right, so this is called bulk flow, this movement. Transpiration, so remember, transpiration refers to water being evaporated and that causing water to be pulled up. Transpiration drives bulk flow of the water in the xylem. Water is pulled up a plant, therefore it is negative pressure. And the xylem have these ring, you can kind of see it in this picture, they have these rings here to make sure that the tubes don't collapse. That's something you don't want to happen. Kind of like if you were to use a straw and the straw collapses, then you can't get anything. These rings help it to prevent collapse. We actually have a similar adaptation in our trachea. Our trachea is right here. And if you feel your trachea, you can feel these rings of cartilage. Those rings of cartilage just prevent your trachea from closing, because that would be very bad if you can't get air in. All right, eventually the water moves up the xylem and it makes it all the way to the leaves. So it's going against gravity and it's going to make it to the leaves. The leaves are covered in stomata, usually on the underside. Stomata are these things in the picture down here. They look almost like weird little creatures with little mouths. And that's kind of what they are. Stomata open and close to either prevent water from evaporating or to allow water to evaporate. Leaves generally have broad surface areas. Why would they have a broad surface area? Well, the broad surface area is going to increase photosynthesis because it, like a solar panel is broad, it allows for more sunlight collection. There is a problem with that. The broad surface area also makes it more likely that water is going to evaporate away. So the broad surface area has a benefit that it allows more light collection, also means more water is going to evaporate. So plants have evolved stomata. And on the right, you can see the stomata closed. This is the stomata right there. And closing the stomata helps to prevent water loss. So that is something that plants have developed to help make sure they don't get dehydrated and start wilting too quickly. All right, transpiration is the loss of water from the shoot to the surrounding environment. And what is going to drive water loss? Well, ultimately, it is water potential. So if we look here, we can see that the outside air has a very, very low water potential. It's air, so the water potential is going to be really low. And in the leaf, it is not quite so low, right? So this means that evaporation is going to happen pretty quickly because we have a big difference in the water potential, -7 in the leaf to -100 in the air. So water is going to move from the leaf to the air. All right, and we see that happening here. So in the picture on the left, this thing that I'm circling is the stomata. So it allows water to evaporate out. And it's also helping to collect CO2. All right. Okay, another picture to review everything that's happening. Water moves up the roots. Here's a picture of the xylem. Water is going up the xylem and eventually making its way out through the stomata. All right. And just another picture, the xylem is here. So water moving up the xylem. The other picture is actually the phloem. So this is showing how sugar is pushed into the phloem and sugar moves down. Just a little FYI. All right, that is all for today. That is our example of osmosis and water potential. Please let me know if you have any questions.